Hi, in this video, I'll be explaining LED floodlights and circuit breakers. Now, many people like using the LED floodlights because they use a significantly lower amount of energy for the amount of lumens. Now, inside the LED floodlights, there is a lead driver circuit, and that lead driver circuit often has a high inrush current. That inrush current becomes a problem when selecting your circuit breakers. It also limits how many LED floodlights one may connect to a certain circuit breaker. In this video, I will be discussing this topic. Right, when a light is turned on, we have something called an inrush current. This is a sudden increase in current versus the time. One can see that this increase in current is almost vertical. That vertical action can initiate a trip on a circuit breaker. Also note that the peak of this current is significantly higher than the nominal current. The nominal current refers to the steady state current, the current that the floodlight uses under normal conditions. So say for example, we install a 30 watt LED floodlight. Let's just assume the power factor is 1, although it never is. That means that the running current would be 130 milliamps or 0.13 amps. So under normal conditions, if the power factor was 1, a 30 watt floodlight operating at 230 volts would only use 0.13 amps. So that would be the nominal current. But unfortunately, when the light turns on, it has quite a high inrush current. And that inrush current depends on a few factors. One of the factors is where the voltage wave happens to be when you turned on the power. For example, if you turned on the power and the voltage just happened to be at 90 degrees, the phase angle, then we would see a sudden increase in the voltage as soon as you've closed that switch. Why this is important is because most LED floodlights utilize a driver circuit, and that driver circuit often uses a capacitor. And what a capacitor does is it charges as soon as we apply a voltage across the terminals. And that is what this high inrush current is. It's the charging of the driver circuit. Now, if we happen to turn on the floodlight at the zero crossing, maybe 180 degrees or zero, we would have a much lower inrush current because the capacitor would charge as the voltage waveform increased. But if we turn on the power at a high point, even over here, we'll see the sudden inrush current. And this is very important because this inrush current can be significantly higher than the nominal current. And why that's important is because we need to specify the circuit breakers based on this inrush current. Right, now I've located this guide to circuit breaker selection for LED lighting, and I just want to show you one of the diagrams. Now, in this guide, they've got a miniature circuit breaker of 10 amps listed over here, and they have these three curves which represent the different curves for different types of circuit breakers. I will go into the curves shortly, but what I'd like to bring to your attention is that on the left axis or the vertical axis, we have the maximum number of drivers. This would be the driver for the floodlight. So in the floodlight, we often find a little electronic circuit. That's what they mean by the driver. Then on the horizontal axis, we have the LED driver rating. So say for example, we're using a 30 watt floodlight, it would most probably have a driver circuit of close to 30 watts. So let's just have a look at what this diagram is indicating. At 30 watts, if I cross the B curve, one can see that the maximum number of floodlights or driver circuits I could have with a 10 amp miniature circuit breaker is only 11. That means that I could only have 11 of these 30 watt floodlights. Now, just going back to my calculation, recall that a 30 watt floodlight uses approximately 130 milliamps. And even if the power factor is 0.8 or somewhere there, it's still going to use a low current, although it will be a bit higher than the 130 milliamps. But if we just compare that to a 10 amp circuit breaker, if I had to say 10 divided by 0.13, I should be able to get 77 floodlights connected to a 10 amp circuit breaker, because if I say 77 times 0.13, I get to 10 amps. Now, keeping in mind that just because the circuit breaker is at 10 amps, it doesn't mean it trips at 10 amps, and I will cover that shortly. And also, there are other factors like the resistance of the wires and the way the cables were run, etc., and the power factor. But we're just talking in a general sense. If I have 30 watt LED floodlights, according to this graph here, I could only connect a maximum of 11, yet my calculation said I should be able to have 77. Even if I was conservative and I made that 60, 60 floodlights would most probably trip a 10 amp circuit breaker. And the reason it would trip is because of that inrush current. Because if my inrush current is so much higher than my nominal current, every time I add a floodlight, I have to account for that increase in inrush current. So if I have 10 floodlights, I will have 10 times the amount of inrush current. So one may see that the inrush current is what is limiting us in having so many more floodlights. Now, circuit breakers follow different curves or tripping curves. So if I show you the different tripping curves for some circuit breakers, it may become clearer why a certain curve, for example, if I used a C curve, I would be able to have even more of those floodlights. For example, if the circuit breaker was a 10 amp circuit breaker following the C curve characteristics, instead of having 11 floodlights, I could possibly have 24 floodlights. So let's just have a look at those tripping curves. And now here's a diagram of different tripping curves on the same set of axis. Now on the vertical axis, this is the time it takes the circuit breaker to trip. Now, if we have a look at the horizontal axis, this is the percentage or increase in the rated current. So if it is at rated current, for example, if it's a 10 amp circuit breaker, we see that the circuit breaker shouldn't actually trip. Most circuit breakers trip at a higher current than the stated rating on the circuit breaker. So let's look at a current rating of 2 times the rated current of the circuit breaker. So if we are having a load that is pulling twice the rated current, so if it was a 10 amp circuit breaker, now it would be 20 amps. 20 amps on this circuit breaker would take about possibly 25 seconds to trip that circuit breaker. Now, this is not very important for the LED floodlights. Now, when we're talking about inrush currents, these are typically below 10 milliseconds, often just a millisecond, 2 milliseconds, somewhere there, sometimes even faster. So we're interested in this section of the tripping curve. Now, let's just take, for example, this section over here. If we have a current that is 4 times the rated current of the circuit breaker, so let's say it's operating at 40 amps. Now, if the circuit breaker is following a B curve, notice that if I have an inrush current of, say, 5 milliseconds, this circuit breaker would most probably trip. But if my circuit breaker followed a C curve, my circuit could then allow for about 6.5 times the rated current of that breaker. So that means that I could effectively have more of those floodlights. Just keeping in mind that the LED floodlight has a inrush current of at least 10 times the nominal current, and this inrush current can even exceed 100 times the nominal current. So let me give you an example of some inrush currents that I've personally measured. Over here, I have some values of some measurements I've taken for inrush current for a 50 watt LED floodlight. Notice that the nominal or running current was only 0.234 amps, but have a look at the inrush current when I turned on that light. Sometimes it was 16 times higher, sometimes 60, 47, 30, 128, 231. So one can see that the inrush current is many times higher than the nominal current. So if we look at the actual current values, I have turned on a 50 watt LED and it pulled 30 amps from my supply. Now just imagine 10 of these 50 watt LED floodlights all asking for 30 amps. 10 times 30 is 300 amps. If I was using only a 10 amp circuit breaker, I would be asking for 300 amps at the turn on of these types of floodlights. So going back to the tripping curves, 6 or 7 times the rated capacity of the circuit breaker is only 70 amps. But recall that it's very easy to quite quickly get a theoretical inrush current of 300 amps. And that is why it is so important to look at these tripping curves. That is why we need to select the correct tripping curve for our loads.
Now, these tripping curves are provided by the manufacturer, so you would need your circuit breaker model number. They'll provide the time delay tripping curves that you can then review. So on this particular one, we still have the time for the trip, but on the horizontal axis, they've labeled it as percentage of rated current. So in this case, 500 means 5 times the rated current. So if it was a 10 amp circuit breaker, this would mean 50 amps. A lot of the time, the tripping curves are shown as a minimum and maximum. This is just because of something called hysteresis. So we'll find that we could expect a trip for this circuit breaker anywhere between these two lines. So say, for example, using this miniature circuit breaker, in the data sheet, you should be able to find the different options for the different curves. Right, getting back to this diagram, remember that this is just a general recommendation. It all depends on the circuit breaker one uses, the manufacturer. Number two, some circuit breakers even state how much instantaneous current the circuit breaker can withstand before it trips. For example, if I just show you the circuit breaker, we've got the thermal trip section over here. So here we've got a thermal trip unit. What happens is it heats up as the current flows through it, and this offers a slower response. If you've got a 10 amp circuit breaker and you're pulling 12 amps from it, it's probably not going to immediately trip. It will have to heat up first and then it will trip. And looking at this curve, you can see that it could take a couple of minutes before it trips. But if the current increases quite a lot, for example, if it goes to 3 times the circuit breaker rating, so in this case, if it was a 10 amp circuit breaker and it was 30 amps, we can see that the trip should be before 4 seconds, and that is because it's now a magnetic trip. The current causes flux to be built up in this coil and cause a magnetic field, and it will trip. And then we've got the instantaneous section, which is a very fast trip because the current is very high, and this is the part that's important when it comes to the inrush current. So therefore, this diagram here is useful as a guideline, but one should always consult the circuit breaker's data sheet for accurate values. Now, just having a look at some of these data sheets for floodlights. Now, if I scroll down, it's got the colors, the light spectrum, and then here are the specifications, but notice that that doesn't give the inrush current. It just says power 10.28 watts, and it might even have the power factor, or one could work out the power factor, but notice that it doesn't state the inrush current. If I have a look at this one from Osram, it just says 10 watts, and there's no other values here that would help me to determine what the inrush current is or how many of these floodlights I could connect to one circuit breaker. Now, this particular data sheet, LEDVANCE, with the 130 watt floodlights, actually states the maximum number of floodlights that one could have on a certain circuit breaker. So if we have a look here, it says maximum number of luminaires on a circuit breaker with a B curve 16 amps. So it's actually saying 10. And if we go to the 10 amp section, we can see that for a 10 amp circuit breaker following the C curve, remember the different curves, it says we can only have 8. If you do a calculation, if I say 8 times 135 watts, that's 1080 watts. But a 10 amp circuit breaker, if I had to say 10 amps times the voltage of 230 volts, is actually 2.3 kilowatts. Obviously, one has to take into consideration the power factor, etc. I'm just giving a crude example, just showing that I can only put 8, even though if I did the calculation, I get to 17. So one can see that one can't just say, okay, I've got a 10 amp circuit breaker and divide that by the nominal current of the floodlight. Unfortunately, the circuit breaker will then trip when all those lights turn on. And here's another product sheet. One can see that the values that they give are very limited. So one can't do much with this unless one actually measures it oneself. And over here, I've got the Smart Light LED floodlight, and they even give the inrush current. So sometimes we do find this. And just keeping in mind that this is a 200 watt floodlight, and here is the inrush current of 11.5 amps. Now you might be wondering, how come this inrush current of only 11 amps for a 200 watt floodlight is much lower than the inrush currents are showed for only a 50 watt floodlight? And the reason is all got to do with the driver circuit. More premium floodlights may be designed to lower that inrush current or to have a soft start and have a different circuit, possibly a bit of an inductance in there to reduce that inrush current, which makes it much easier for office blocks where you switch on an entire floor of floodlights. And also there are a variety of devices that one can buy to reduce the nuisance tripping, such as monitoring the voltage waveform and only allowing the current to flow once there's a zero crossing. And lastly, one mustn't forget that different lights have different turn-on characteristics. And because of this inrush current, we often have to increase the conductor sizes. So that means that the wires that are fed to the floodlights also need to be considered carefully. And according to the SANS 10142 standard, we actually double the sum of the lamp load in watts for the compact fluorescent lighting. So for example, if you're using these compact fluorescent or fluorescent lighting, say they are 20 watts, you actually count each globe at double the wattage in order to specify the correct wire size. Just remember that the circuit breaker must always be able to protect the wiring. And if you'd like to see how I measure the inrush current, please check out the video. The link is in the text below and also in my playlist on electrical tutorials. All right, well, I hope that was helpful, and thanks for watching, and cheers.